So before I tell you what this talk is about, let me tell you what this is not about. And before I tell you that, let me introduce myself. So I'm a very standard product of the Indian education system. I am an engineer, then I got an MBA, and then I got into a tough job such as management consulting. On the side, however, I had this very special hobby where I was interested in self-help books, personal development books. So I'm on a quest to identify those fundamental principles that make a difference to people's lives. And after almost 20 years and reading more than 300 books in the areas of motivation, leadership, coaching, biographies and autobiographies of successful people, attending a few training programs, applying these principles to my own life as well, and closely watching a lot of lives of people around me, how they had evolved over the years, some realizations became very clear to me, which I then captured in the books that I have written. This talk is not about, this talk is not something where I will say that, you know, life is all positive, or you should be the happiest person alive that you know of, or if you just focus hard enough, you can manifest your reality or anything that you want right now. We all know that that's not the way life works. We know that there are things which we want, but we don't get them, and definitely not at the times when we want them the most. So what I will essentially focus on here is basically a concept of causality, where people say that, you know, how much of what happens to us in life is destined, or how much of it is random, or a lot of people say it's somewhere between being destined and being random. And that's actually not the focus of this talk, on how much of what is destined or random. I'm sure a lot of people in this room will be along the different points of that debate, right? But there is something we will all agree to, that shit happens and it's normal. And that's the focus of this talk. That shit happens, it's normal. We will not focus on why it happens or why it should not have happened. We will focus on, now that it has happened, what do we do to deal with it? And not just deal with it, but deal with it like a pro, like we are the heroes of our lives. And now that we are in a tough situation, how do we handle it and come out by flying colors? We know we are all different, right? We all have different starting points. Some people are born with more resources. Some people don't even have the very minimum resources to take care of themselves. However, there are still things that we all have in common, things that make us human, right? We feel happy when we get something that we want. We feel content when we give back. We feel disappointed when we lose something we so badly care about. We feel hurt when we face a setback, and so on. But there is still something about the human spirit that I absolutely love. So many of the times, if you look at ourselves and the people around us, on so many days, we are massively bruised within, right? We wake up, but we are massively bruised within, and it can be because of multiple reasons, right? You just got to know of an illness that you picked up, or you were so badly expecting a promotion, but you didn't get it, or you faced a very serious heartbreak, right? Nonetheless, we still get up, dress up, and show up to do what we are supposed to do in the multiple roles that we fulfill, right? As employees of our organizations, owners of our businesses, fathers or mothers, brothers or sisters, sons or daughters, friends, and lastly, the citizens of our country and the world at large. So whenever we are presented with a situation in life, there are actually two ways to which we can respond to it. We can either go below the plane of the situation, be low on energy, and then whatever results we produce from there will not be good enough. The other option is to just go on top of the situation, be more resourceful, and then whatever results we produce from there will be actually better for us. And the key to all personal development lies in taking ourselves to that level and living life from there. This is one of the key differentiators of a lot of successful people. And we've kind of heard that essence come out from all the talks that we have been listening. Yeah. Which brings me to my idea that stays. Irrespective of what happens to us, we can be better off assigning empowering meanings and responding to situations from a more resourceful or positive state rather than assigning disempowering meanings and reacting from an unresourceful or a negative state. We cannot always control the outer world. Our bodies change, economies change, people, even the ones who are closest to us, change. However, what we can almost always control is the meaning that we assign to whatever happens to us, right? That brief moment when we get to know of something and when we assign a meaning on what that means for us is what I call the moment of the I. That is our free will at play. So let's understand this process basically, right? An event happens, we assign what it means for us. We take an action based on that meaning that we assign, and we have a corresponding result. Now, as you can see, if the same event happens to two people, one assigns a positive meaning and one assigns a negative meaning, in the end, they will end up producing very different results, right? So in this talk, I would like you to come with me on a journey where we will understand this process, and we will also understand how we can take ourselves to that more resourceful level, and we can live life from there. So based on all the research that I did over, you know, all these 20 years, 300 books, talking to people, understanding from their experiences, I came up with this framework. This is what I call the Begin With I framework. It has three areas and it has eight elements. To me, this is the map on which every person can be plotted. Literally, each of us, including me, we can map ourselves on this, saying how good are we doing on each of those elements. And if we continue to master these individual elements, we can continue to master our inner world, which then will have a direct impact on how we handle the outer world and create more from a place which is more resourceful. So we create more outcomes that we want for ourselves. Yeah. So let me quickly walk you through this canvas to give you an illustration of how successful people map differently on it compared to some others. And we have already heard a few terms in this talk, right? So self-image is basically how we see ourselves. Self-image is the sum total of all the beliefs that we have about ourselves. And it is very widely established that people rarely achieve more than they imagine themselves to be capable of. So a lot of successful people have very healthy self-images. And what I mean by healthy self-image is not that they will win every time, but I mean is that they will give their best shot every time, which then essentially increases their chances of success. Our beliefs are the glasses through which we see the world. And I call them glasses deliberately because they can be changed. And whatever beliefs we hold eventually turn out to be our facts, because most times we act in accordance with them. A belief that a lot of successful people have in common is that everything happens for the good. Let me tell you what this belief does for them. It keeps them in a mode where they're always forward-looking and continue to take constructive action. A lot of other people, however, will spend a lot of time and energy constantly trying to evaluate, oh, this was good, this was bad, this was good, this was bad. The way the life is structured, and we know, or not structured rather, we know that we will never be able to know till the end whether something which happened was good or bad for us. So a better view is to just have a belief everything is good and keep taking forward action. Our charisma is how the world sees us. A lot of successful people are naturally, authentically charismatic, which comes from having a high level of self-awareness. We heard in a few talks as well how people knew what they kind of wanted, right? So I get a lot of questions whenever I'm talking about charisma. People are asking me, is there even any point in trying to enhance my charisma? I will never become a Gandhi. My answer to them is this: you might not match up to a natural or an original, but but you can definitely raise your level from wherever you are right now to that point and then reap the benefits of that accordingly. Inspiration is something to look forward to. It is something which will add life to you, something which will make you come alive. So a lot of successful people, they are able to do one or both of these things. First, they know what they're passionate about. So they make a lofty goal for themselves and they run full speed towards it. Or if they don't know what they're passionate about, which is where 95% of the people are, they are able to reframe the way they look at their jobs or their relationships or their lives, reframe them to look at them positively so that they can bring their own passion to these things, right? Goal setting, of course, we all make short-term, long-term goals. However, we don't leverage full power of this extremely powerful tool because we don't write the goals down. When you write it down and you stick it somewhere that it is visible to you every day, that really makes it achievement much easier. So once we know who we are and we know where we want to go, it's time for relentless execution. And that is what intensity is about. If there is one skill which can make them completely invincible or unstoppable, it will be getting up each time they fall. And that's what intensity is about. Mind control is about what we focus on. People who get successful are typically quite good at this. They're able to consciously shift the focus of their mind onto things which they should be doing rather than which takes them away from the objective. And that's what champions are good at, right? They can go by the days even when they don't feel like doing what they should be doing, right? Self-talk is basically a voice in our head which constantly keeps talking to us. It's very ironical because it hardly ever shuts up, but a lot of people don't even know it. And now that I'm talking about it, maybe some of you will feel it for the first time. Successful people are very good at converting this self-talk from the default negative, discouraging, downplaying tone, which is because of the world we live in. They convert it to talk to them in a way like a cheerleader or a coach would do. So they have a conversation with themselves, but this time they are being encouraged rather than being discouraged. And lastly, time management. I call time to be the greatest leveler because no matter who we are or where we are, we all have 24 hours in our day. This again, successful people find ways to really make good use of their time, because you can talk to anybody. Everybody will tell you that they wish they had more time in their lives. They could have contributed more. They could have, actualized more. They could have contributed more and so on. So once we have talked about the canvas, we understand it. Let me tell you a little bit about my story on how I had to do work a lot on this canvas over all these years, right? So whenever I used to talk about my urge to give back my learnings in the form of books or courses, whatever I had learned, I used to also face a lot of stiff resistance from people, right? It's very obvious. When you tell people, I want to write a book, the first person you will tell it to might not be the one who will encourage you, right? And then try it with 100 other people. So I faced a lot of resistance saying, oh, these books will never happen, the courses will never happen, you are just talking about them. So I think from there, you need a strong self-image, you need a healthy self-image, you need to believe in something which is not existing right now. The only place the books were existing was in my mind. You have to believe in something which is not existing, but you see it very clearly. You have to have a passion because it requires late nights, especially since I was in a very hectic profession. So it requires late nights, it requires sometimes you're writing on the flights. Goal setting, of course, you need to be having strict timelines. Mind control, of course, because every time somebody discourages you, you need to bounce back like this, that okay, heard your opinion, thank you very much, I know what I'm doing, move on. Self-talk, again, it's a constant process. You keep working with the way you talk to yourself. And lastly, time management also. Because I was able to do this, I was able to kind of realize my dream in terms of two books that I have written. I have 7 live courses, as they mentioned on Udemy. It is extremely actualizing to know that people from 133 different countries are enrolled in my video courses. So coming back to this this canvas, right? There are two approaches a normal person can follow this, right? So the first is, if you are somebody who is comfortable making a lofty goal for yourself, because that kind of inspires you, so I would encourage, look at each of these elements, make a lofty vision for yourself, like imagine your best self 5 years from now, where you will be. Look at each of these elements and make a work plan and start achieving that. If you are somebody who doesn't like lofty goals, and which is again, I would say 90-95% of the people are there, where lofty goals kind of scare them, just start with making small improvements. Very, very small improvements. Pick 2-3 areas and make small improvements there. There's something magical about this canvas. As soon as you make positive progress in each of these elements, it starts to reinforce the other elements. So before you realize, you will become much more effective than you had even imagined previously, right? So when I share these learnings with people, I typically find that a lot of people kind of know this stuff. You know, when you tell somebody, oh, you know, how to be successful, self-image, beliefs, time management, people will mostly say, yeah, I know that, but I struggle with the implementation of these principles in my very hectic, otherwise day-to-day life, right? I would say the issue is they try to do everything alone, and that's why they are not able to do it. So I believe there are 2 levels of support which people can seek. The level 1 is your overall environment. This is basically the city you live in, the organization you work for, your extended family, acquaintances in general. So let me give you an example. If you live in a city which has an excellent public transportation system, you just have to sit in there. So instead of sitting in there idle for 1 hour or 2 hours every day going, coming back, just use that time very effectively. You can read something, you can listen to an audiobook, you can draft some emails, or you can even just do something which refreshes you so that once you reach home or you reach office, you have a different energy level, right? So leverage that level closely. There's another level, which is what is the peer group. We all are social beings, and actually, we don't even know, but this level impacts us the most. So you rarely achieve more than what your peer group has been achieving as well, right? So peer group includes your family, your close friends, college, office colleagues with whom you're spending a lot of time. So they tend to have a lot of impact on the choices that we make day to day, right? And typically, each time you will try to make a change to your lifestyle, this is where the strongest resistance will come from, that what is this new meditation that you want to do now? So a strategy which people don't know how to do is to leverage this group. So announce it openly to them what you want to do. When you announce something in advance to people that, look, I'm trying to do this because of this, they usually feel responsible and they will help you achieve your goals instead of, you know, coming in conflict with them. Lastly is you. You basically, some of us know, are things like wear a wristband which constantly reminds you of something, or have put something on the bathroom mirror so you can, you know, constantly see your goals written down there every day and things like that, right? So I think before I close my talk, let me just reemphasize that I'm saying all this not because I want each of us to become some, you know, superhuman kind of, you know, achievers who are just achieving a lot. I'm doing it because let's just continue to live the life that we are living. Let's just be slightly more happier and slightly more wealthier along the various areas of life, which is physical, which covers your health, which is financial, which covers your money. Intellectual is the work that you do, be it job or your business. Social is your relationships. And lastly, spiritual, which is about the fulfillment or contentment that you have, so that as each of us becomes more, we can give back more to our families, communities, and the world at large. Thank you.